there. In this, the second part of my Frost tutorial, I'm going to cover how to create the other versions of this scene that we're eventually going to composite together to give the overall effect. So I'm going to cover how we create this version of the scene where you can see there's a dynamic paint effect going on, and then we're going to use that to shift between a version of the scene that has no frost and the version that does have the frost in order to give us this effect of the frost growing over time. Like that. So this is where we finished in the last tutorial. There'll be a link to the previous tutorial in the description below. And you can see we've got our frost, we've got our particles and so on. So the first thing I'm going to do is actually just hide those particles just to make it a bit easier to do everything. So we'll just turn them off here. I'll leave them on in the render. And I need to select my bowl, turn them off on there, and then finally select the water and turn them off there. So that makes it a bit easier to do things. Now, if you want to move the camera as I did, now is the time to do it before we go on to the next section. So obviously I just moved the camera, took the camera, I put it somewhere else at the beginning of the animation, I keyframed it, I came to some way through the animation, keyframed it again. That's all I did. I just made it a relatively slow motion as the scene progressed. For this demonstration, I'm not going to worry too much about that. So we'll stick with a static camera view for this one. You could even have objects moving and things like that. It would work for that too. So what we need is some duplicates of this scene. Strictly, you could just create the output type that you need, then recreate the whole thing again. But of course, what often happens is you need to make small adjustments, and having the scenes in there in parallel allows you to see how they're going to interact together. When I was making it, I was having it composite actually in Blender directly so that I could see what the output would look like. And that's going to be quite useful. Ultimately, I rendered out to three separate image sequences, which then allowed me to composite later and make whatever changes I need to during the composite. So you'll notice up here we've got this thing called scene. It's been there every time you've rendered something and you've probably never done anything with it. Now we're going to use it. So we're going to click in here and I'm going to call this frost scene. What I now need to do is click this little plus up here, add a new scene, and we get several options. For this one, just to keep things simple, I'm just going to say full copy. So this is going to make a duplicate of this entire scene. The objects aren't going to be linked in any way. There are useful reasons why you might want to link them, but for this demonstration, we're just going to have a copy. So I've done that now. You see it's called Frost Scene 001, but it's actually identical. There's no difference between one scene and the other at the moment. So the first difference is this is going to be a version of the scene that we're going to use for other things than frost. So I'm going to call this mask scene. And then I'm going to create another duplicate. I haven't changed anything in this one yet. Full copy again. And this one I'm going to say no frost. So there are now, if I click in here, three versions of the scene. One with the frost, one without the frost, and in the middle, one that we're calling the mask scene. They each are going to work slightly differently. So we'll go to the no frost scene to begin with. Now you have to be a little careful here and bring up your outliner. You can see we've got the three scenes here and I've selected the table, and you can see it's selected the table in this scene. Be very careful because it's very easy to have, say, the table in the no frost scene selected and then go to the frost scene and for things to still be selected incorrectly. In this case, it's fine, but it's very easy to get things mixed up, especially with materials. So the first thing I want to do is actually remove the particle systems from everything in this scene. And actually, I should have removed it from the mask scene as well, because I don't need it in there either. But that's easily done. So making sure we're in no frost, we'll just click the minus there, and that's got rid of that particle system. Same for the bowl, and same for the water. So if we preview that now, you can see there it is. Now we've still got some materials to adjust for the water because it's still showing the sort of frozen water, but that's basically it. So let's adjust the water material now. So I'm going to select the water, which I haven't named, but is that circle. If I press G, so now I've selected the water, you can see there it is. I'm just going to pull down another window and we'll open the node editor and we can remind ourselves of the material. So I don't need any of the ice effects for this one. So I can take away quite a few of these nodes, put the water index of refraction down to 1.33. We'll turn the transmission up, put it to 1 for the moment. We'll set the roughness to 0.01 and we'll set the base color to full white. and I set clear coat down to zero just so that it doesn't interfere. And this is where you can see that there may be a reason to use refractive caustics. If you watch this dish, if I turn refractive caustics on, you can actually see it's a little bit more light coming through. We may want to look at increasing the number of bounces here as well. Let's turn the surface noise down to zero just so that we can see what we've got. But generally, I would put a small amount on here just to give a slight ripple to the surface. Make it quite a small value and probably not need that color ramp as well. Let's put the roughness down to 0.001. The next thing which I found to make a little bit more of a difference was to turn on filter glossy. So this should just sort of reduce some of the noise you're getting. So I'll put 3 under filter glossy. So this is the render settings. And you can see that gives us much more light out of here. It's noisy, and obviously taking refractive caustics off removes that, but you can see we lose a lot of light as well. So we want both, really. Just trying some higher values. It doesn't seem to make a vast amount of difference, but I think as long as you have at least one on filter glossy, you'll get a bit more light out of the bottom of the bowl there. I had 3. And a lot of this noise will be smoothed out anyway later on. By the way, while we're here, don't forget to turn on this little clock, which will help to make sure the noise pattern is different every time it renders an image. So that's created our basic water. So now we'll go to our mask scene. So at the moment, that's an identical scene. But this time, we actually don't want any materials at all in this scene. So I'm just going to go to material here, so we can see what has and hasn't got materials. So at the moment, I've got the water selected. Come over to materials and just click minus for the moment. Then the bowl, minus on that to remove the frost material, and minus on it again to remove the bowl material. And then finally the table, do exactly the same again. There are no materials assigned here now. We also don't need a light in this scene, so I'm going to take the sun away. So I'm going to select my water again, and we'll create a new material now. I'm going to call this material mask material. Doesn't matter what you call it, of course. I'm going to remove the default diffuse, and I'm going to add a shader which is a mix shader, and that drops into the surface there. I'm going to add a shader which is an emission shader, and I'm going to put that into one side. Strictly, I need to add a diffuse shader on this side, but we could probably get away without even putting anything on there. I'm going to put the emission shader just up to full white there. So if the mix is all over to this side, we get black. If it's over to this side, we get white. And you can obviously swap that over by just swapping that here. That's the way we're going to go for the moment. Now, I am going to add another node, but before I do that, there's something else I need to do in this scene. So I'm going to select the table, then holding shift down, select the bowl, and then finally select the water again, and then click this little arrow and say copy material to others. So they've all got the mask material. They've all got the same material on them now. And you can see we're looking at the mask scene right now. So now I'm going to add a new object. Just going to add a cube, bring it up here somewhere above the scene, scale on the X just to make it a little thinner, and then scale on the Y to make it a little bigger there. Go into edit mode and just drag it up so that the origin is just down here somewhere. Doesn't really matter, just makes it easier to rotate like that. I'm going to start it off about here. And before I go any further, I'm going to say make this wireframe. I'm going to come down to cycle settings and say don't render anything. So this object is, for all intents and purposes, invisible. While I think of it, let's go to the render settings. I'm going to turn off shadows here. We don't need shadows in this scene anyway. So I've got my object here. I'm at the beginning of the timeline, and I'm going to press I and say location rotation. So I've stored its position. I'm going to come to perhaps around about halfway through the animation, and I'm going to push this object over to here somewhere and press I and select lock rock. Before I do anything else, I'm going to go to the graph editor, select key and say interpolation mode linear. So that'll mean it will just travel the same speed throughout the scene. It won't slowly speed up and slowly slow down again, which is what the default setting is. Back to the node editor at the top. So I go back to the beginning of the animation, press play, and I have this object obviously just moves in a simple way across the scene. So now go to particle settings with that new object selected, say new. So that's creating a particle system, and press play, and you can see it's dropping particles across our object. And I'm just going to set this to 150 frames at the moment, so it'll just keep cycling around. So I want it to emit particles for the duration of it moving across, which is 150 frames. The lifetime doesn't have to be all that long. They're falling right the way through already, so perhaps it only needs 25. That'll help with lag a little bit. We'll go with a random distribution as well, and I'll emit from the volume. So we could play around with this to get this to emit straight down, but it really doesn't matter. The whole point is that we will just have a sweep of particles move across the scene like that. And that's really all we need that to do. We can play around with the density of the particles later if we feel that's not enough. So the next thing I need to do is set this object as a dynamic paint brush. So click dynamic paint over here in the physics settings, select brush and say add brush. Paint source needs to be a particle system, and it's the only particle system on that object. I'm going to say use radius and we'll leave the rest at default. Next, let's select the table. Dynamic paint again, this time make sure canvas is selected and press add canvas. You can already see something starting to happen. We're getting little dots appearing. And this is why we need quite a few vertices on this object. Select anti-aliasing, which will just smooth it out a little bit. Now, if it's not good enough, you can switch to image sequence, but I stuck with vertex. It just means you need quite a few vertices in there. You may need to use substeps as well if the particles are moving particularly quickly. Mine was okay. We may need more particles than this, however. Turn off dry, for this effect at least, and then come on down to the next section. Note what that is called. So you can see we've got DP paint map and DP wet map. Click the little plus next to DP paint map and that changes to grey. Come on down to dynamic paint initial colour and I just selected colour and left it white. Then come on down to dynamic paint effects. I said use spread. For my particular model, the first time I did it at least, I had 0.5 for the rate of spread. This is how fast it spreads. So this is, imagine some ink or something has dropped onto some paper and it's spreading out, or it's a wet patch that's spreading. The fact that you can see the sort of blockiness of the vertices on here isn't necessarily a problem because we're not really using this directly. We're just using it to reveal patches of frost. But if it's still too blocky, you can add more vertices. You could just go into edit mode, press W and subdivide. It's not necessarily a problem that is more vertices than we have in the other scenes. So that's got quite a few vertices now. And now you can see we're getting a lot more splotches appear. So that's not necessarily spreading quite fast enough. Obviously, we can now tell it to go all the way perhaps to frame 250, where the particles have stopped. So if we come to frames under dynamic paint, we need to set that to the end of our animation, or at least to the point where we're interested in seeing the spreading effect. And you can see that carries on spreading and slowly fills up. And as you've probably guessed, we're going to do exactly the same thing with the bowl. And you may find you need to do a slightly different speed of spread for different objects, because obviously with less vertices it may spread too quickly and so on. And then finally, we need to do the same for the water as well. And there it goes. So that's now creating our mask layer, and we can now add the final node to the material. So this is a common material between them, of course. We're going to add an input, which is DP paint map. If you've given it a different name, you can just say an input, which is an attribute, and then just type in the name that you put in there. But by default, you get DP paint map. We'll take the factor output and we'll put that into the factor controlling this mix shader. So if I go to rendered view now and we scan back, you can see everything's black and slowly turns white as the frost covers the scene, which is what we are simulating here. So I'm going to cover how we render and then composite in the next tutorial, but what I will do now is just do a little bit of the compositing just to show you how we combine those three scenes to see how they're working together. So for the frost scene, so this is the original scene, we've got a basic render layer at the moment, and we'll rename that as frost layer. We'll come to the mask scene and we'll rename that as mask layer, and then the no frost scene and we'll rename that as no frost layer. So we'll just render that now, but I'll set it to a relatively low number of samples and we'll go to 50% as well, just to make it quicker. So it's a 25 sample and we'll just render that and see what happens. So I'm in the no frost version of the scene at the moment, And you can see all it did was render that. So what I need to do now is to make it do a little more than that. It didn't render the other scenes, hasn't obviously combined them together. So if we now go to positing options and say use nodes, all we've got at the moment is this one node from the no frost scene. So let's create another node, and I'll connect that into the output at the moment, but we'll change this one to select the frost scene. So if we render now, I'm still in the no frost scene, which is worth remembering. So there is the no frost version of the scene. So here it goes, it's doing another render now. It's taking longer because it is going to render the frost this time. I didn't turn it off for the render itself. So you can now see in the preview here, we've got two different versions of the scene. One without the frost and one with it. So I'm now going to add a color mix node, drop that in there. So if we are over to the right, we've got the frost version, and over to the left, we've got the non-frost version. So all we really need is to be able to control between those two. So I'm going to create a new node, and as you've probably guessed, I'm going to set this one to the mask scene. And the output of that one is going to control the mix. Now it may not be quite that simple, but let's see what that looks like. So let's give that a render. So there's the no frost scene. That was the frost scene, and now it's doing another one. And there we go. So you can actually see that this scene is controlling where we can see the no frost scene and where we can see the frost scene. If I take this out of here, you can see there we are. And the further to this side we are, less frost would actually be visible. You can then play with that by adding a color ramp, for example. So you might want it to be a little smoother, use B-spline, and then narrow the points in, and you can even just look at the scene directly so you can see what it's looking like. Looks like I had the frost on there for some reason. So if I go to my mask scene, it looks like I forgot to remove the frost from this scene. Yeah, the frost particles are still there, so we'll delete those. Go back to our no frost scene, and we'll give that a last render. So that's rendered. And we can now just play around with how the frost is working. You can see we can expand it or shrink it there. And then put this back how it should be, which is controlled with the frost there. So you can see if I adjust this side, we can actually grow the frost, especially with B-spline selected here. And if I push this side up and that one out up to this side, you can see we actually move some of the frost. You don't necessarily want it to be too harsh a difference. We've got a slight issue there. That's not something that would necessarily be visible anyway. But you can see there, we basically have now a mechanism for revealing one scene compared to the other. And you could just render that straight out, either directly to an AVI file or an image sequence, which is what I would recommend. But ultimately, I think once you've got the general idea of whether it's working, you're much better off rendering this out to three separate image sequences and then compositing those and adding a few effects along the way. And I'll show you that in the final video of this sequence in the next tutorial. Hope you found that useful, and if you did, let me know, and I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot. So I hope you found that interesting. If you did, let me know. If you enjoy these tutorials, don't forget to click like and subscribe. I also have a Facebook page and a Twitter account, and I now have a Patreon page as well, and I'll provide links to all of those in the description below. So I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.